We begin with a surge unlike anything we've ever seen. That is how one medical expert describes the alarming rise in cases as the Omicron variant spreads like wildfire all across the country. The U.S. obliterated its record, now averaging more than 300,000 cases a day. Hospitalizations are also climbing to more than 84,000, up 70% in the last month. At least 10 states are reporting their highest hospitalization numbers of the pandemic. More than 1,500 Americans are dying each day from the virus, an increase of 72% in the last month, and the CDC now predicting tens of thousands more could die from COVID in the next 4 weeks. But there is some positive news, and that is new research from South Africa finds that a Johnson & Johnson booster shot provides strong protection against Omicron. All right, let's begin our coverage with CNN's Elizabeth Cohen on these alarming numbers. And Elizabeth, I know we've been talking a lot about numbers, but there really is a big concern about how this is going to impact our daily lives.
That's right, because, you know, we've heard so much, Amber, about how Omicron is so transmissible, but it tends to cause mild illness. Overall, that's true, but here's the problem. The cases are getting so huge that even a small percentage of a huge number can still be a big number, and that's what we're seeing with hospitalizations. A relatively small percentage are ending up in the hospital, but again, a small percentage of a big number is a big number. The CDC does its regular forecast. Let's take a look at their latest one. If we look right now, we're averaging about 9,400 new hospitalizations per day. The CDC's forecast, 17,400 new hospitalizations per day by mid-January. If we look at deaths in the last 4 weeks, 39,000 deaths have happened in the past 4 weeks in the United States. The CDC forecasting that in the next 4 weeks, there will be an estimated 45,000 plus deaths. Again, yes, Omicron milder, but it's so transmissible. Now, as you said, there is a bit of good news here. Let's take a look at a press release from Johnson & Johnson. This has not been peer reviewed, but this is what the company has put out. They say that if you get the Johnson & Johnson shot and then a booster 6 months or more later, when they looked at a population in South Africa, they saw that it was 85% effective against hospitalization compared to people who are unvaccinated. Also, antibodies, other parts of the immune system were increased, so that's good. But this is a big but. The CDC still recommending that people get Pfizer or Moderna, both for their original vaccinations and for a booster. Amra?
All right, Elizabeth, thank you for that. So New York is the epicenter of this huge surge. The state just shattered its record for daily cases, reporting more than 67,000 cases yesterday. The fast spread of the virus is putting a tremendous strain, as you'd imagine, on hospitals and causing major staff shortages among first responders in New York City. CNN's Polo Sandoval live in New York with more. Polo.
Emma, those numbers are telling as they are just staggering alone, with New York State experiencing about a 67% increase, rather 65% increase in the new number of COVID cases, that 67,000 number they just shared yesterday. The total number of New Yorkers who tested positive just yesterday. So that is certainly significant here. It's a new high. And many of those that have recently tested positive are some of New York City's first responders. And that's when you begin to worry about potential staff shortages. Just look at these numbers coming from FDNY, showing that 30% of EMS workers currently on medical leave, about 17% of firefighters. These numbers are nearly double what they were just last week. Now, we have heard from authorities who are assuring the public that they do have the manpower, they do have the ability to actually reshuffle some of their manpower to make sure that no calls go unanswered, but it certainly speaks to just where we are right now amid this winter surge here. Now, we did hear just a few moments ago from incoming New York City Mayor Eric Adams basically laying out his plan for taking New York City through these unprecedented infection numbers. They include keeping that very bold vaccination mandate in place that's specific when it comes to the private sector, and then also laid out that he at this point has no plans on shutting the city down again.
Today, I'm rolling out my administration plan to keep New Yorkers safe from the virus and keep our city open. That's the goal. We can't shut down our city again. We can't allow the city to go further into economic despair.
Now, Adams also saying that one of the items that he specifically wants to look at is the number of New Yorkers who have not completed their vaccination series, basically got that first shot and never came back for their second, and then, of course, not their booster either. So that's one of the areas that he wants to look at. But again, making that promise that he does not want to close that city again and wants to explore other options, including boosting testing. Amara?
Yeah, that I'm sure is reassuring to a lot of people. All right, joining me now is Dr. Mary Bassett. She is the acting health commissioner for the state of New York. Dr. Bassett, thank you so much for joining me. Let's start with these staggering numbers that Polo just ran through. Case numbers at an all-time high, hospitalizations surging, and, of course, more essential workers calling out sick because they have the virus. What are you most concerned about when you look at these numbers?
Well, you're right. The number of new cases continues to go up. Our most recent number today is that we have 74,000 people who tested positive. And our hospitalizations are going up as well. I think in the midst of all the sea of numbers that we all hear swirling around us, we have to keep focused on a key message, which is that people who aren't vaccinated, now is a really good time to reconsider your decision not to get vaccinated. For people who are fully vaccinated, and that's 70% of all New Yorkers statewide, actually 71% now, we need you to get boosted. And for people who've gotten one dose, which is at a real high for adults, 95%, we need you to go back and get that second boost, get that second dose, get boosted. So let's keep our eye on the tools that we have and remember masking. Masking is an important additional layer of protection.
Those updated numbers, you know, continue to be staggering. Now you're up to 74,000 new cases in New York.
That's right.
Does this mean, Dr. Bassett, on the ground then, especially when it comes to the healthcare system and people calling out sick? Are there enough workers? Will you have to rely on the National Guard?
Well, we are, you know, tracking these very closely and communicating with the city about them. At the moment, we certainly have enough hospital beds, but we're seeing more hospitalization. And as you know, we sounded an alarm last Friday on December 24th about the disproportionate rise in hospitalizations for young children, for children. So at the moment, we are okay with hospitalizations and bed availability. We're putting in place measures to make sure that we continue to be able to respond to hospitalizations. Whoever pointed out that a small fraction of a big number is still a big number got it exactly right. That's been our concern. Our tools remain the same, though. Let's keep focused on getting people vaccinated. Let's remember to wear masks, avoid crowds when we can. Be careful during the upcoming holiday season about how we plan our time and plan for the most vulnerable person in our group and make sure that these gatherings remain safe for them.
Right now, Dr. Bassett, you're saying things look okay when it comes to the hospitals in New York. And, you know, on that note, you know, New York shortened the isolation period for fully vaccinated healthcare workers and other essential workers, what, from 10 to 5 days. And this happened before the CDC issued its new guidance. Do you think that is making an impact? Are you seeing the guidelines, I guess, alleviate the worker shortage, at least in the healthcare industry?
Well, let me just explain the guidelines briefly. We applied these guidelines to people who are fully vaccinated, not just health workers, a whole range of workers, who have either asymptomatic infection, the people who went out to get tested before the holidays and found out that they were COVID positive, feeling fine, and people who were mildly symptomatic and whose symptoms were improving. And we had a whole host of boxes for people to check, no fever in 72 hours, no runny nose. And for those individuals, 5 days of isolation is enough. We were not telling people to go to work sick. This is for people with asymptomatic or mild infection. And they, the best data that we have suggests that this infection comes very quickly. It has a very short, what we call incubation period, and people remain infectious for shorter periods of time. So this is a safe period of isolation, especially for people who are vaccinated, asymptomatic, were mildly ill. And that's the recommendation in New York State.
Right. And in New York State, the isolation guidelines specifies it's for the fully vaccinated in these industries. The CDC guidelines that were just recently updated, it doesn't differentiate between the vaccinated or unvaccinated. Do you agree with the guidelines in general? And do you think that the vaccinated should be singled out as New York did?
Well, we're, you know, we're aware of the CDC guidelines. We have it by a press release and media conversations. We're hopeful that they'll give us a bit more. We expect to update our guidelines and align with them. We always seek to align with the CDC. But at the moment, we are remain with the guidelines that we have for New York State, which are focused on the vaccinated worker. We know vaccinated individuals shed less virus than people who are unvaccinated. There are a whole host of reasons to get vaccinated, but probably the most important is people who are vaccinated are less sick.